Good evening and welcome to Gravitas. I'm Palki Sharma, Upadhyay. Let's get started. Tonight we'll talk about West Asia. It's a complicated region, flush with oil and conflict. There are multiple wars, power play, big money and religious divides. Enter China and things are already looking worse. China is selling ballistic missile technology to Saudi Arabia, or so the Americans claim. They say they have satellite proof of this. This is bad news for the US, also for the region. It's no secret that China has been selling missiles to the Saudis. It's no secret that China has been expanding its presence in the region. It has big ticket deals in almost every country in West Asia. It is simultaneously doing business with sworn enemies: Iran, Israel, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, all of them, the whole lot. Unlike the Americans, who made a lot of noise, bought oil and loyalties, the Chinese are sly operators. They're edging Washington out one deal at a time. On Gravitas tonight, we'll start with a missile technology transfer to Saudi Arabia and what it means, and then go on to discuss what China is doing in the region. Also on the show, India pushes for the restoration of democracy in Myanmar while also engaging with its coup leaders. What is New Delhi's strategy? We'll discuss that. The US bans the imports from China's Xinjiang, all imports from China's Xinjiang. Major brands feel the impact, but it's a step in the right direction. Islamic world is split on the Tablighi Jamat after Saudi Arabia linked it to terror. A Pakistan assembly has passed a resolution supporting the Jamat. We'll tell you what they said. And does holiday gifting bring you joy, or does it make you stressed and anxious? There is science to support both the emotions. Full story coming up ahead. We begin as always with Gravitas Global Headlines.
Japan announces plans to not send any government officials to February's Beijing's Olympics and stops short of calling the decision a boycott. China reacts, urging Japan not to politicize sports. At least 39 people killed as an overcrowded night ferry caught fire in Bangladesh. Terrified passengers leapt overboard to escape the blaze. The cause of the fire is being investigated. A Minnesota jury found former police officer Kimberly Potter guilty of manslaughter.
In Hennepin County, state of Minnesota, find the defendant guilty.
In the fatal shooting of a black man named Dante Wright. Supporters of Wright were seen cheering outside the court when the verdict was announced. Amid a surge in COVID cases driven by the new Omicron variant, several European nations, including Italy, Greece and Spain, bring back compulsory outdoor mask mandates. Meanwhile, more than 2,000 flights have been cancelled globally over the Omicron variant. Ecuador becomes the first country in the world to make coronavirus vaccinations mandatory for all, including children as young as 5. South Korea will grant a special pardon to former President Park Geun-hye, who is serving a term over corruption charges. His pardon is aimed at promoting national unity amid the pandemic, says the Justice Ministry. Japan unveils its biggest ever full-year budget, including record defense spending to counter intensifying regional security threats posed by China and North Korea. The Philippines, battered by one of the worst typhoons in its history, More than 650,000 people have been uprooted from their homes. Two-time World Cup winning spin bowler Harbhajan Singh has announced his retirement from all cricket at the age of 41. Singh played his last international in 2016, but had continued to feature in the IPL and ends his career as the fifth highest wicket taker in tournament history and four titles. He played 103 tests, 236 one-days, and 25 T20s for the Indian team, and his overall tally of 711 international wickets is the second highest by an Indian bowler. The English Premier League has been forced to postpone a third Boxing Day fixture as COVID-19 continues to disrupt the busy festive schedule. Everton's match against Burnley on Sunday is the latest to be called off, while Liverpool versus Leeds United and Watford versus Wolves had already been deferred on Thursday. 13 matches have now been postponed due to rising COVID cases in the last 2 weeks.
A major shift is underway in West Asia. A major power is losing ground. A rising power is winning friends. New rules of engagement are being written in a volatile region like West Asia. Such changes rarely come without risks. They can always spin out of control and lead to dangerous consequences. Our cover story tonight is a brewing threat. China is arming Saudi Arabia. Well, we've known that for some time now. So what's new here? China is not just equipping the Saudi forces, it is teaching them how to make advanced weapons. Ballistic missiles, to be precise. A new report says Riyadh has set up a secret site with the help of China. The facility is near Dawadmi in Saudi Arabia. China is believed to have shared sensitive ballistic missile technology with the Saudis here. Reports say these are large-scale transfers, and Beijing seems to have sent multiple consignments already. Now, the Saudis have always wanted to expand their ballistic missile program. They asked the Americans first and repeatedly. Successive U.S. administrations have declined Riyadh's requests. So the Saudis turned to China, and Beijing seems more than willing to help. The Chinese military is involved in this project. Reports say the Saudis approached the People's Liberation Army, more specifically the PLA Rocket Force, for this. This is the missile branch of the Chinese military, the PLA Rocket Force. The Saudis have an old relationship with the PLA. In the past, they've bought missiles from China. Now they're getting technology too, and the know-how, so they can make their own ballistic missiles in future. And this is a dangerous development. It raises the risk of proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. In a region like West Asia, this is like lighting a matchstick around a gas leak. Ballistic missiles can be used to deploy both conventional and nuclear weapons. And there is suspicion that China is helping Saudi Arabia expand its nuclear program too. Last year, a report came out. Apparently, China has helped Saudi Arabia build a facility for uranium, a factory to make uranium yellow cake. This is a milled form of the uranium ore. If it's processed and enriched, it can power a civil nuclear energy plant. It can also be used to fuel a nuclear weapon. These developments are worrying for Washington, D.C. It is said to be mulling sanctions against Chinese players, those who are involved in transferring ballistic missile technology to the Saudis. They might be sanctioned. But what about Saudi Arabia? Will the U.S. sanction the Saudis too? There is no such indication. The U.S. does not want to snap a relationship that is already adrift. U.S.-Saudi ties are not in their best phase. There was a time when Saudi Arabia was considered the linchpin for America's West Asia strategy. Well, not anymore. A lot of things have changed. One, America's reduced dependence on Saudi oil. In fact, in January this year, the United States did not import any oil from Saudi Arabia. This happened for the first time in 35 years. The imports have not completely stopped, but America is slowly weaning off Saudi oil. Because Americans are now a net exporter of oil themselves. In fact, in 2018, the United States became the world's largest crude oil producer. So when you're yourself a seller of oil, why would you need oil imports? So the use of Saudi oil in America is on a steady decline. Also in decline is America's support to Saudi Arabia's military campaigns. Joe Biden has ended support to Riyadh's offensive in Yemen. The U.S. president pulled out significant military hardware from the region, like U.S. missile systems. Donald Trump, remember, was bullish on Saudi Arabia. Joe Biden is not. Saudi ministers criticize America's approach. They say American policies are muddled and confused. They make announcements, but when it comes to getting the work done, nothing happens. That's the complaint from Riyadh. So they're expanding their options. They're moving closer to China. And it did not happen overnight. China's relationship with Saudi Arabia goes back decades. And interestingly, this relationship too was built over missiles. In the 1990s, Saudi Arabia felt threatened by Iran and Israel. The kingdom decided to arm itself with ballistic missiles. Guess where they got them from? China. In December 1986, the Chinese sent 50 medium-range ballistic missiles to Saudi Arabia. The Chinese also taught the Saudis how to use them. And here's something else that's worth noting. Saudi Arabia displayed these missiles only once in public. It happened in 2014 during a military parade. Pakistan's then Army Chief, General Rahil Sharif, was visiting Riyadh. So from the 1980s to now, the relationship has expanded. China is no longer just an arms supplier to Saudi Arabia. There's a deepening energy partnership too. Saudi Aramco has made a 50-year-long commitment to Beijing. China is now Saudi Arabia's top trade partner. In 2020, China exported goods worth more than $28 billion to the kingdom. There is increased engagement between the leadership too. Xi Jinping visited Riyadh in 2016. In 2017, King Salman visited China. 2 years later, Crown Prince MBS traveled to Beijing. These personal visits signal the importance that both sides attach to the partnership. And high-level contacts could have enabled the transfer of advanced military hardware. China has not participated in Saudi Arabia's military campaign in Yemen, but it could end up igniting a new conflict. With Chinese help, Saudi Arabia is boosting its arsenal. It's a move that will not go unnoticed by regional players and might end up fueling a new weapons race in West Asia. Now, China's West Asia policy is different from America's. Washington went all guns blazing. They wanted puppet regimes and oil. China, on the other hand, is a silent killer. It feeds you loans. It sneaks in joint projects. And before you know it, China owns you. They're trying the same policy in West Asia. The money goes in first, the politics follows. Of course, they've had some help from the United States here. In 2011, remember, President Barack Obama of the U.S. announced his quote-unquote pivot to Asia. And since then, the U.S. has rolled back from the Middle East. The result is this, a big political vacuum, one that China is keen on filling. Now, in that part of the world, deals are not struck over drinks. They're struck over barrels of oil, and China has got that covered. Around 48% of China's oil is imported from West Asia. That's more than $78 billion. With that kind of money comes political clout. On the other hand, America is chasing energy independence. They don't want to buy West Asian oil anymore. Let me show you the numbers now. In 2001, the U.S. was importing 2.8 million barrels per day from the Persian Gulf. In 2008, 2.4 million barrels per day. And in 2018, 1.6 million. In the first week of this year, 2021, the U.S. imported zero oil from Saudi Arabia. Zero oil. Do you know how much China bought from Riyadh? 1.67 million barrels. 1.67 million. This oil money was China's gateway into the region. And as we know, Beijing does not need a second invitation. They started striking deals with royal families, with dictators, with religious hardliners. China has the luxury of not caring about rights or freedoms. For them, it's all about money and power. Their biggest West Asian deal is with Iran, a 25-year cooperation program. What does the deal say? China will invest $400 billion in Iran. In exchange, Tehran will sell oil at a discount rate to China. That is the deal. But Beijing has bigger ambitions. You see, Iran is geographically blessed. It links West Asia, Central Asia, and South Asia. It's an ideal candidate for Xi Jinping's Belt and Road Initiative. China also has projects with Iran's sworn enemy Israel. From 2011 to 2017, Chinese companies invested $15 billion in Israel. They have opened two innovation centers. They're running electric trains in Tel Aviv, and they will soon operate a new terminal at the Haifa port. We're also learning about some secret defense deals. Earlier this week, three Israeli companies were found guilty of illegally selling cruise missiles to China. They carried out tests, they produced missiles and sold them to China, all illegally. They were paid millions of dollars by the Chinese government for this. Next up, the UAE, another American ally. In 2019, China and the UAE signed a $3.4 billion deal. The idea was to use the Jebel Ali port to export Chinese goods. Now, do you know what's special about this port? The US Navy uses it a lot. It is their busiest port of call outside the United States. And these are some of the bigger investments. But Chinese money is sprinkled all over West Asia. Almost every country in the region has joined the Belt and Road Initiative. Let me pull out the list. Bahrain, Iraq, Iran, Kuwait, Lebanon, Oman, Qatar, the UAE and Saudi Arabia. All of these countries have joined the BRI. Most of them are American allies. Some of them are sworn enemies. And all of them are doing business with China. How did they manage to do this? Because China is a blank slate in West Asia. No history of interventions, no colonial past, no stake in the power struggles just yet. China is pretending to be a businessman in a war zone. They're cutting deals with the UAE, they're buying missiles from Israel, they're building roads in Iran. It's a typical Chinese strategy, lead with the money. But West Asia, you see, is a tricky theater. Global powers eventually get bogged down here. It happened to Britain, it is happening to America. The question is, will it happen to China? Or are China's ambitions limited to money? Foreign investments inevitably mean foreign presence, offices, private security, things like that. They always follow. And we know how volatile West Asia is. One tiny standoff with the locals or one social media hashtag could trigger a crisis. As for the US, this is a do or die. For decades, they have dominated this entire region. They have built alliances, fought wars, invested billions of dollars. How can Joe Biden protect this position? Through some diplomatic shrewdness. He knows what Israel wants, more recognition from the Arab world. He knows what Saudi Arabia wants, more support for the Yemen war, plus some breathing space on human rights, perhaps. He also knows what the UAE wants, more investments, more tech, and more respect. Does this mean making huge compromises? Yes, it does. But frankly, Joe Biden is running out of options. The sands are clearly shifting in West Asia. And this time, there's a red tinge to the new top layer. Now, they say in geopolitics, there can be no black and white. These binaries do not really work. They stop us from seeing the world for what it often is, complex, nuanced, and full of all the shades in between. So sometimes you have to take tough decisions and act in self-interest, which is what most countries do most of the times. Case in point, India's strategy in Myanmar, a neighbor that has been in turmoil since February this year. It's been 11 months. The Myanmar army launched a coup. They toppled Aung San Suu Kyi. They seized power. In these 11 months, we've done countless reports on the situation in Myanmar, on the protests, on the detentions, on the killings, the dialogues for peace, the calls for restoration of democracy, all of it. But the military junta remains unmoved. It has not responded well to international pressure. The West has made democracy the sole prism of its policy on Myanmar. It has imposed sanctions, cut off financial assistance, and closed channels of communication. Unfortunately, India cannot do that. India shares a 1,700-kilometer border with Myanmar, a porous border prone to insurgency and militancy. As many as six separatist outfits have camps here. In the past, they've attacked India's security forces from their bases in Myanmar. So India's relationship with Myanmar has a clear security dimension. Simply put, India is not spoiled for choice here. It doesn't have many options. It cannot afford another difficult neighbor. It has to engage with whoever is in power in Myanmar. So earlier this week, India made its first outreach. India's Foreign Secretary, Dr. Harshvardhan Shringla, visited Myanmar's capital, Naypyi Taw. This was the first visit by an Indian official since the coup. What for? To emphasize on the need to return to democracy. That's what the Ministry of External Affairs says. to push for the release of all political prisoners, to call for dialogue and a quote-unquote complete cessation of all forms of violence. This is what India is pushing for. It was a two-day visit. The Indian Foreign Secretary met military generals, political parties and members of civil society. The most important meeting was with this man, the chairman of Myanmar's State Administration Council, Senior General Min Aung Hlaing, the man who led the coup. Foreign Secretary Shingla also met with leaders of the National League for Democracy, that's Aung San Suu Kyi's party. Reports say he sought a meeting with Suu Kyi herself, but the military denied that request. India also offered a gift of 1 million vaccine shots. What do you make of these engagements? Is India legitimizing the military regime or just keeping channels of communication open? What does being committed to democracy but also engaging with dictators really mean? A one-word answer is pragmatism. Given India's unique security challenges, it's important to play the cards well. Remember, last month there was an ambush on the India-Myanmar border. In the state of Manipur, a paramilitary convoy was attacked. 5 people were killed. The attackers were 2 insurgent groups, the People's Liberation Army of Manipur and the Manipur Naga People's Front. They took responsibility for the attack and all evidence suggests they were operating from camps based in Myanmar. And that's part one of the problem, insurgent groups. Part two is drugs. Earlier this month, there was a drug haul in Manipur. Drugs worth 500 crore rupees along with 54 kilograms of brown sugar and 154 kilograms of meth. They were all seized from a Burmese trafficker. So there's terrorism and there's narco-terrorism and then there's China. It is investing heavily in Myanmar, selling weapons, building trade corridors, launching infra projects, pulling the military junta into its corner. So what does India do when there's a coup? Western sanctions are not working. Western threats are definitely not working. Slamming the junta in Myanmar is easy, but it's a losing strategy. Engaging them while pushing for the restoration of democracy, well, that's tough. But all things considered, that's India's best bet. Let's talk about the U.S. now. Washington, D.C. is pushing China for the genocide in Xinjiang. U.S. President Joe Biden has approved a new law. It bans all imports from Xinjiang. It also sanctions those who force Uyghurs into factories. This law is a bold step. Who will it impact? Anyone with a business interest in the American market, all of those companies. The U.S. government wants businesses to behave responsibly, to stop using factories that employ forced Uyghur labor, and to stop importing goods made by them. Major Western companies are guilty of using Uyghur labor. I'm talking about names like Apple, BMW, Gap, Nike, Samsung, Sony. Last year, an Australian think tank identified 83 brands. From all sectors, technology, clothing, automobiles, all of them, they're either American companies by origin or they want to sell their products in the United States. But they were all unable to keep their supply chains clean. In fact, many American companies tried to resist this law. Tech giant Apple, for instance, they actively lobbied against the law. Footwear giant Nike did the same. It spent more than $900,000 to push back against this new law. Coca-Cola, we are told, spent more than $4 million last year on lobbying efforts. But for a change, the lobbyists did not win. America has banned all imports from Xinjiang. Needless to say, China is not happy.
On December 23rd, United States signed the so-called Uyghur Forced Labor Prevention Act into law. This act ignores facts and truth, maliciously slanders the human rights situation in China's Xinjiang and seriously violates international law and basic norms governing international relations, which is an act of gross interference in China's internal affairs. China is strongly indignant at it and firmly opposes it.
China says the claims about Xinjiang are fake news. The fact is, the U.S. is hitting China where it hurts the most, the export sector. It represents close to 18% of the Chinese economy. Exports is what made China an economic powerhouse, and Xinjiang plays a major role in those supply chains. The region is about twice the size of Texas. It supplies raw materials like coal and oil, food items like tomato, clothes and sneakers, electronics, basically all kinds of consumer goods come out of Xinjiang, but Xinjiang's biggest export is cotton. This province provides one-fifth of the world's cotton. Exporters of all of these commodities will be hit with this new American law. They're already reeling under previous American bans. Remember, the U.S. has also banned products made from Xinjiang cotton. 87% of China's cotton crop was blacklisted. The result was this. One major exporter in Xinjiang lost business worth well over $50 million. Companies like Patagonia, Gap and IKEA said they will stop shipments from Xinjiang. The latest American ban will have a bigger impact. How does China plan to respond? Beijing is resorting to nationalism, bullying American companies, weaponizing its market, and pushing Chinese citizens to boycott American goods. The latest victim is Walmart. Walmart runs a subsidiary called Sam's Club in China. It's a grocery chain. Sam's Club removed products from Xinjiang from its stores. And for this, they're facing the wrath of Chinese citizens. Many are cancelling their membership to Sam's Club. A campaign has begun on the Chinese internet. It's got more than 170 million views on Weibo and more than 10,000 posts. The hashtag Sam's Club Xinjiang is going viral in China. It has got at least 1.7 million searches in the country. Does all of this sound familiar? It should, because China has done this before with brands like Nike and H&M. They tried to end their dependence on Xinjiang, so they faced boycott calls. Chinese burnt Nike shoes. H&M was forced to shut 20 stores. Remember, China is a big market for these companies, so they tried some damage control. It did not help. Because once China paints a target on your back, nothing helps. Look at what happened with Intel. It asked its suppliers to not use anything that comes out of Xinjiang. As expected, a backlash followed. State mouthpieces said Intel had committed the quote-unquote biggest offense to the Chinese market. Intel's brand ambassador in China ended his ties with the company. The chip maker decided to apologize, but Beijing is having none of it.
We have noted the relevant statement and hope that the company concerned will respect the facts and distinguish right from wrong.
That message is not just for Intel, by the way. It's for all the businesses who are thinking about breaking ties with Xinjiang. The Chinese state will not hesitate in boycotting them. So what should brands do? They should stand up for what's right. They should deal with temporary inconveniences, even losses and nasty campaigns. Because in this day and age, ignoring human rights is also a bad business strategy. No amount of marketing will help you if you support a genocidal regime. The American ban is just the start. Other countries will soon join. There is a growing demand for a similar ban in Europe. China's genocide in Xinjiang is simply too big for the world to ignore now. And here's another problem that Beijing is dealing with. A new wave of Wuhan virus cases sweeping the country. 13 million residents of Xi'an are now under lockdown in China. New hotspots are emerging every day. More than 70 cases have now been detected in eastern China. And this is the official figure, remember, so take it with a pinch of salt. At the end of 2020, Xi Jinping had declared China's victory over the virus. But 1 year later, China's pandemic playbook is failing. Our next report tells you why.
This is Xi'an. 13 million people are under lockdown here. The reason is the Wuhan virus. More than 200 new cases have been found in this city. Chinese authorities have turned it into a war zone. A massive force of health workers recently marched into the city. There is chaos inside departmental stores. The lockdown led to panic buying. People were seen beating each other up for food supplies. Beijing is responding with what it has mastered of late, a crackdown. 26 officials have been fired in Xi'an. Why? Apparently, they did not do a good job in preventing an outbreak. Perhaps they did not, but the problem won't end with their dismissal. China is bracing for a bigger wave of cases. The eastern province of Zhejiang is reporting an outbreak too. 74 new cases have been detected here. These numbers may appear small for large cities and provinces, but remember two things. One, this is Chinese official data, so unreliable. And two, China is paranoid and follows an impossible zero COVID policy. Now it's battling a new wave. So what's fueling it? The reason is not clear. But Chinese authorities are worried about Omicron. At least 6 confirmed cases of the new variant have been found, and Beijing is worried about the Winter Games. Chinese officials fear that more people will test positive.
Spread of Omicron and other variants have brought a great degree of uncertainty to the global pandemic. During the Winter Olympics, there will be a large number of participants arriving in China from different countries and regions. The flow and congregation of people will sharply increase. There will be a certain number of positive cases. This is a high probability event.
China's strategy to tackle the pandemic is failing. Its zero COVID plan has not been able to stop fresh outbreaks. Now there are growing concerns over Chinese vaccines. Studies have shown that China's Sinovac shot is ineffective against Omicron, even with a booster. All citizens have been inoculated with only Chinese vaccines. They could only be vulnerable to an Omicron infection. As the world deals with a surge in Wuhan virus cases, Beijing increasingly looks unprepared to deal with what's coming. Bureau Report, WION World is One.
Two weeks back, Saudi Arabia banned the Tablighi Jamat. We reported on that. A transnational Sunni Islamic movement, which Riyadh said posed a danger to societies. It called the Jamaat a gate to terrorism. It prohibited all its activities on Saudi soil. Now, in what seems to be a tit-for-tat move, Pakistan has passed a resolution supporting the Tablighi Jamaat. This happened on Tuesday. The Punjab Assembly in Pakistan, where Imran Khan's party happens to be in majority, unanimously adopted a resolution calling the Tablighi Jamaat a force for good, a non-political, peaceful organization that's working for the propagation of Islam globally. Their words. Now, it's unclear what the resolution plans to achieve. It only looks like a gesture of solidarity with the Tablighi Jamaat, also a retaliatory move against Saudi Arabia. The statement they issued clearly indicates this. Allow me to quote. Tablighi Jamaat is a global organization. It has nothing to do with terrorism. History has shown that these people have never been involved in such activities. They're earning goodwill for Pakistan with preaching of Islam all over the world. Let me repeat. They're earning goodwill for Pakistan. Now let me show you a few headlines from January 2016. When the very same Punjab Assembly in Pakistan had banned the Tablighi Jamaat from universities, they also banned it from mosques surrounding all universities. Why? Because they thought the Tablighi Jamaat was sympathetic towards terror outfits, that they would try to mislead young students and spread sectarian hate in society. 5 years on, the same Punjab Assembly in Pakistan is praising the Tablighi Jamaat, lauding it for bringing goodwill to Pakistan. Why? What changed in these 5 years? For one, the Pakistani government. The Prime Minister of Pakistan, the current one, is a known sympathizer of fundamentalists. Of late, he's been striking peace deals with almost every extremist outfit in his country. He recently struck a ceasefire agreement with the Tehreek-e-Taliban. It's another matter that it failed later, a month on. He also bowed to the demands of the Tehreek-e-Labbaik, TLP. So a resolution praising the Tablighi Jamaat should not be much of a surprise. There are elections coming in 2023. Imran Khan is only securing his vote bank. At the same time, we can't help but ask, what sort of goodwill does the Tablighi Jamaat really bring for Pakistan? Because last we checked, it was being linked to terror attacks on Pakistani soil. In 2010, a massacre unfolded at a mosque in Lahore. 94 Ahmadiyya Muslims were killed after being taken hostage. The law minister of Pakistan, the Punjab province, went on record to state that the attack was facilitated by members of the Tablighi Jamaat. And that's not all. Pakistan's own security analysts have written in detail about how former missionaries of the same Tablighi Jamaat have gone to form and serve in some of the most dreaded terror outfits. Like the Harkatul Mujahideen, Pakistan's own investigators have said that this outfit was formed by former members of the Tablighi Jamat. The thing is, Pakistan cannot pick and choose when the Tablighi Jamaat is a threat and when it is not. It cannot be banning the outfit on some days and then calling it a force for good on others. Pakistan needs to draw the line for its own good. As it is, appeasing fundamentalists has never worked in Imran Khan's favor, and he should know this by now. It's Christmas Eve, which means Santa Claus is already on his way on a sleigh. I'm kidding, Santa is not real, we know that. But sometimes it's easy to forget. I mean, he's all over the place, on billboards and advertisements, at shopping malls. Everywhere you look, you see his flowing white beard. Now, usually Santa is a welcome guest on Christmas, but in Norway, he has triggered a debate. Can Santa Claus be gay? That is the question. Norway's government certainly thinks so. Their postal service has released an advertisement for Christmas. It's called When Harry Met Santa. I'll give you the broad strokes. You know, kids write to Santa about their gifts. A lot of them do. Well, in this ad, we see a grown man writing to Santa Claus. And this is what he wrote. All I want for Christmas is you. And guess what? Santa obliged. Here's the broadcast-friendly version of what happened next.
Ja, vi fikk tak I litt assistanse I år, så jeg kan være sammen med deg.
What do you make of that? Well, Norway is confused. We're talking about a deeply conservative society here. Until 1972, homosexuality was illegal in Norway. The average age there is 40, so it's an aging conservative population. How did they react to this ad? With mixed emotions. This video was supposed to celebrate 50 years of legalizing same-sex relations. So one section was all praises. They said it reflects the progress made by Norway. Another section was not impressed. They said it sexualizes Santa Claus. Plus, apparently he's cheating on Mrs. Claus. Let me point out the obvious flaw with both the arguments. He's not real. Nonetheless, it's a debate worth having. We've all grown up with a certain picture of Santa Claus. Plump, white beard, red clothes, and lots of gifts. We've also heard about Santa's helpers, the elves and Mrs. Claus. Her job is to make cookies for the elves, feed the reindeer, and make toys with her husband. Casual sexism aside, this was always the story. Santa was happily married to Mrs. Claus. So when did he become gay? You can see what Norway's government is trying to do here. They're trying to break barriers. They're trying to normalize same-sex relations. So Santa Claus obviously looks like a good candidate. But have they taken it too far? YouGov put this question to the British public, a simple yes or no question. Can Santa be gay? That's what they asked. 39% of the respondents said yes. It is acceptable. 41% said no. A gay Santa is not acceptable. This poll has revealed some interesting trends. Age, for instance, is a deciding factor. The younger people are okay with a gay Santa. The older population is not. Here's how the numbers stack up. In the 18 to 24-year-old category, 60% people said a gay Santa is acceptable. In the 50 to 64-year category, only 31%. Clearly, there is a generational change happening. And by the way, it's not just sexuality. Santa is now a case study for everything. Gender, race, size, ethnicity, everything. For instance, is a female Santa Claus acceptable? Mother Christmas instead of Father Christmas. Well, here's what the poll found. 27% people said it is acceptable. 54% said it's not. And this time, there is no age factor. Across the board, people have rejected female Santas. I know this is a difficult debate to have. Most of us do not even think about Santa's sexuality. We're just concerned about his gifts. Santa Claus is supposed to be fun and jolly. Should he be sending messages on sexuality? Should he be kissing anyone on television, man or woman? As the polls show, it's a divisive issue. So at the end of the day, I guess it's up to you. But I will say this, marketing campaigns aside, governments need to focus on some policy as well. In Norway, for instance, where they put out this ad, same-sex relations were legalized in 1972, but conversion therapies were legal until this year. So good PR is never a substitute for good policy. Legal rights and safeties are not a substitute for creative ads. And we've got one more holiday story for you. It's about picking the right gift. It's not a problem for Santa Claus. Somehow, he always knows what to get. But what about us mere mortals? Trust me, gifting can be a double-edged sword. It can be a lot of fun or a lot of pressure. It depends on how you tackle it. We've got a secret Santa thing going on here in our newsroom. It's been a lot of fun. People are secretly leaving their gifts near workstations. They're huddling around and discussing what they got. This is what gifting is all about. In fact, if you do it right, it's good for your health. Gifting can lower your blood pressure and stabilize your heart rate. At least that's what scientists in California say. They conducted a unique experiment involving 90 students. First, they were exposed to a stressful situation, so their heart rate shot up. Next, they were divided into two groups. One group was asked to send a gift. The other was asked to receive a gift. Guess which group had lower blood pressure and heartbeat? The one that sent gifts to their loved ones. They fared better. What exactly is the science here? Frankly, it's not clear. The scientists are calling it pro-social behavior. Pro-social behavior, what does that mean? Basically, the warm glow of giving. We've all felt it at some point in our lives. If you help someone out, or if you make a loved one happy, how do you feel? I'm sure you'll feel happy and content. And that is called pro-social behavior. Gifting is no different. You're making the recipient happy, and in turn, you are happy. It's as simple as that. But handing over the gift is easy. Picking the right one, well, that's the tough part. And nowadays, you've got so much to choose from, so many brands, so many products. It's not really easy to narrow it down. Plus, your mind starts playing tricks on you. You start doubting yourself. Will your child like a new toy? Will your dad love his new watch? Are you spending too little on your gifts? All of these doubts start rushing in. We call this holiday gift anxiety. It's a real thing. And guess who capitalizes on this? The corporate world. The more anxious you are, the more money you spend. I'm talking about billions of dollars here. In 2019, the global gift market was worth $61 billion. By 2024, it could be worth $67 billion. That's a lot of money on gifts. The big spenders are Britain and America. The average American spends more than $1,200 on holiday gifts. In Australia and Canada, around $1,000. Russia, around $330. If Santa charged money, he would be a billionaire. Jokes aside, this holiday season was another challenge. A massive chip shortage. You can't make anything without a chip nowadays. Your mobile phones, your tablets, your appliances, everything uses a chip. Most tech companies have admitted that there will be problems. Take gaming consoles, for instance. Chances are you won't find them online. And if you do, they won't be delivering anytime soon. So prepare for such worst-case scenarios. Plan ahead, and most importantly, don't stress out. Gifting is supposed to be fun, you see. It's supposed to be a token of love and joy. So here's my two cents on holiday gifts. Number one, it's the gesture that counts, not the gift. You don't have to buy something fancy or something rare. Sometimes a handmade gift is more satisfying. It shows the recipient how much effort you've put in. And number two, try asking them. I know people love surprises, but do you know what else they love? Getting something that they've always wanted. So go ahead and ask your loved ones what they want. And number three, it's not a competition. Don't think about what someone gifted you last year or what your friends got this year. Just focus on the task at hand. Find something nice, hand it over, wish them well, show them your love. So keep these three things in mind on Christmas. Gift or not, make sure you have a great holiday and you stay safe. That's more important than anything else now. We're wrapping the show, leaving you with Gravitas images. Thanks for watching. Merry Christmas. We'll see you on Monday.
เดี๋ยวต้องการเพื่อนมีเอาทิ้งเธอเด็ดโน่นที่ละวันอัดโน่นเป็นเพลงลาบิงอ้อนเว้ยเดี๋ยวต้องเนี่ยเพียงพักการมาเด็ดสองพักอีก